finally time for our main event of the evening. And Matt, we talk about this all the time, about bad blood, about really good fight bookings. This is one of those ones that made a lot more sense when it was originally booked a few years ago, UFC 227. It was going to be the unification bout between Covington and Woodley. Covington played a little bit of hardball, a little bit of surgery, and then it gave a path to Darren Till to take on Tyron Woodley. Now, we all know how that ended. Tyron Woodley kind of shook that I'm a boring fighter type of moniker, went out there and put on an absolutely amazing performance against Till. And then after that, it didn't go well for him against Kamaru Usman. And if you look across the cage of Colby Covington, his last fight was against Kamaru Usman. It's been a while. It has been a time. Now, he was putting on a great performance. There were a lot of people that had him winning that fight into the fifth round, where Usman just absolutely poured on the pressure and earned the TKO victory. So what does Colby Covington do? Well, now we're at MMA Masters. We're no longer at American Top Team. Now, that's not to say that MMA Masters is a bad gym. I mean, we've seen Ricardo Lamas, Danny Garcia recently had a really good fight in the UFC coming out of MMA Masters. So those are just a couple of quick names off the top of the dome that are representing that gym. But in terms of bad blood, in terms of fights, this one, I feel like it would have been more hyped if it happened a couple of years ago, but I'm just glad that we at least get it now, because you have a tale of two different fighters. You've got Covington, who he's lost before. I mean, he's 15-2 to this point, so it's his second pro loss in a title fight. It's tough. He's put on good performances. He had that moniker after kind of the stun gun fight where he became the bad guy. Then right before the fight with Kamaru Usman, he kind of revealed the curtain that I'm not really a bad guy. I'm just trying to market myself. Shh. Don't watch this interview, but really everybody watched it. So you've got Covington, who's in a weird spot. He just is. And then you have Tyron Woodley that didn't perform well against Kamaru Usman, didn't perform well whatsoever against Gilbert Burns. And the stat that always jumped off the page to me about Tyron Woodley, and he's just a hair above Robert Whittaker for the welterweight lead in takedown defense percentage. And it says on the UFC statleaders.ufc.com, it's 91.1%. It says on UFC stats that it's 90%, but I'm just going to say it's really good. The weird thing for Tyron Woodley is the fact that he got taken down in his last two fights against Gilbert Burns and Kamaru Usman. You say, well, Craig, I mean, Kamaru Usman is like the best wrestler at 170 pounds. Is Gilbert Burns the best wrestler? He took down Tyron Woodley. Tyron Woodley's incredibly tough to take down. And we know how shy he was to open up with his hands. And I know he said leading into this fight, he's going to open up the hands. Man, like, there was so much promo on Woodley coming back to fight Burns that he was going to go back to the old brawling style, and it just didn't happen. And if you're a baseball fan, I'm going to liken it to what happened to Rick Ankiel or Jared Saltomachia at one point. It's almost like he's got the yips and he just can't get over it. It's weird because he's getting taken down by, yes, Gilbert Burns. We talk about him. We talked about him earlier on in this series. He's finally got the takedowns together. He's got his striking. He's such a complete fighter. But for him to get takedowns like that, it's weird.
Okay, I agree and disagree with a little bit, so let's just break it down quick. Tyron Woodley himself said after the Gilbert Burns fight that he felt great in that fight. It just Burns the better guy. And I think you do have to take him at his word on that. Because what he said after the Usman fight, he just said, like, I felt off. And take that for what it's worth. I did think he looked better in the Burns fight than he did in the Usman fight. Now, maybe that's just because Usman is, you know, he's Kamaru Usman. Like, and other than stopping on feet before that last Masvidal fight, like, he was considered by many to be maybe not number one pound for pound, but on his way to getting there. Like, I think it's realistic that we could see Kamaru Usman be champ for, you know, 3, 4, 5 years at welterweight. That's really how good he is. Gilbert Burns as a striker, though, is much better than Usman. And that was the problem with the Woodley fight. Burns has two things going for him. He has, A, great timing on his takedowns. He has just really good MMA IQ, so that when you start to unleash with any of your strikes, which what Woodley did, the second Woodley would kind of load up to throw a big right hand, that's when Burns would shoot and go for the takedown. And then the other time he got into the ground, he dropped him in the first round. So that's the key with Tyron Woodley, too. If he has a bad first round, he'll never win another round for the rest of the fight. Like, if you can really demoralize him, and again, I'm not in his head. Maybe these are the improper words to use, but he seems like one of these fighters. And you can hear the broadcast talk about it too. Like, Michael Bisping talks about it all the time, how Woodley, when he's in a fight and things start to not go his way, he kind of gets down on himself a little bit. You can hear it in the way that his coaches coach him. I know him and Dean Thomas are really close. And Dean Thomas, in his corner constantly, is like, just trying to will him into the fight. Like, hey, like, we got to let our hands go. You can't win a fight by not throwing any punches. Like, he's brutally honest with him, but we still see the same thing from Tyron Woodley. And another great quote from Dean Thomas, I think it was just this week, I believe it was on the Ariel Helwani show, where he said, like, your motivations at 40 are a lot different than your motivations at 25. It's very easy to go out there and get into fistfights for money when you're young. But as you start to get older and you're growing your own brand and whatnot, like, it's really hard to still want to do this for a living. And the issue that I have, I can't think of any fighters who have crossed that threshold of I'm a tentative fighter now and have ever come back from it. I really do think it's one of those things that once you lose it, you just kind of lose it. The desire, I don't think, will ever come back. I think that you can do things in a manner in which that your training camp might be as best as it could be, and you can do everything like you did when you did have that desire, but there's always going to be that one little thing that wasn't the same. And for Woodley, he's fighting not to lose still. When you're champ, and we see it from a lot of people, GSP is probably the most famous example of, gets a bunch of finishes, becomes champ, and starts fighting a little bit more conservatively. And Woodley was a great example of that too. And I think a lot of those criticisms were just at the time, especially how, yes, he knocks out Robbie Lawler. And the Wonderboy fight, the first one, was actually really good. It was fight of the night on one of the better cards ever. But the second Wonderboy fight was awful. And the Maya fight was terrible. And the Till fight was good, and that's really been the only good performance, though. He's really shown, even in the Till fight, Till walked into a big shot and then got dominated on the ground. And I don't want to take anything away because that was a super impressive performance. And I think if it was anyone else than Tyron Woodley, they'd get a lot more credit for it. But Darren Till's been his only good performance in the last 3 years. And that really worries me for a guy who is fighting an opponent in Colby Covington who can either do or exceed a lot of the things that have forced him to lose his last two fights in Woodley.
And the trouble for me, again, it's the Robbie Lawler fight, July 2016. How's Robbie Lawler really looked since that fight?
Not good.
Not that great. And okay, that's fair. A lot of people like to go back to this fight. And Matt, I mean, as an aside, and with full transparency, like we like to do with Fight Night Picks, before I get into MMA media and tried to be as impartial as I could, I was a huge Tyron Woodley fan.
Craig loved him.
I have a picture in my office of Tyron Woodley over top of Josh Koscheck. That fight was amazing. The trouble with looking into that, that was 7 years ago. It doesn't lend any credence whatsoever to this fight. It's great that Chuck Liddell knocked a bunch of guys out in the early 2000s. How did he look against Tito Ortiz a few years ago?
Very 53.
It meant nothing. Now, that's a totally different set of circumstances, and it's a poor comparison, and I shouldn't have probably tried to bring it into this. But my point is, it's tough to look too much into those Tyron Woodley fights, and you can really only assess them for, all right, the Till fight was great, and that was 2 years ago, just a little over 2 years ago. But since then, his last two haven't looked good. And yeah, he talked quite a bit about how he wanted to get back to the way that he was fighting going into the Gilbert Burns fight. Now, I know how good Gilbert Burns is as a fighter, and the pressure that he puts on you and the awkward angles he can throw, and you have to worry about the world-class jiu-jitsu, and his striking just continues to get better and better. Yep. He'll throw a low kick. He'll pepper in a combo with the boxing. He'll press you up against the cage. He can do so many different things well that he just overwhelms opponents, and that's a great key to victory for Gilbert Burns. So we've talked so much about Tyron Woodley. Let's focus on Colby Covington, because the thing with Kamaru Usman, when we looked at all, you know, his way up to the title, was the fact that Kamaru Usman, the output can go up, or at least it stays the same. He's on his bike. And in the fight against Colby Covington, he outlanded Covington in terms of total strikes. We look at Colby Covington, and in the RDA fight, he took him down. 7 total takedowns in that fight. The fight against Robbie Lawler, took him down 10 times, and the striking numbers were insane. He beat Robbie Lawler incredibly badly. 2 5-round fights, won the interim belt against RDA. Before that, the Damian Maya fight. Was it a little bit closer than you'd want a fight to be against Damian Maya? Probably. Before that, stun gun, and of course, the bad guy persona, and maybe Barbarena, took him down 12 times, took down stun gun 8 times. You know what you're going to get out of Covington. His hands have progressively improved, especially, and it's a bit of a cheat. The fight against Kamaru Usman, you have 2 primary wrestlers. Are they going to wrestle each other? No, it's going to be a kickboxing fight, and that's what we got. So it makes for a very interesting stylistic matchup, because Tyron Woodley has all that power. His offensive takedowns, when he goes for them, they're great. And his takedown defense is, I'd say it's just good. It's the best all time in the division. So you can't take that from him.
No, and there was, it's just one of those classic Joe Rogan stats, because at one point he was just like kind of saying the same thing for every fight all the time, because it's a stat he would associate with a fighter. Tyron Woodley was, I believe, like 32 for 33 on takedown defense attempts.
McDonald was the only one.
And yeah, Rory McDonald was the only guy who'd ever taken him down. That was in the third round of their fight, and he did dominate him once on top. And the really bad thing about a lot of wrestlers, and it's no, like, it's not a criticism. If you're really good at wrestling, how much time are you spending on your jiu-jitsu if you're not, like, a Grant Dawson or a Khabib type? A lot of wrestlers, once we see them on their back, it's just such an uncomfortable position for them because they're not used to it. If you're a highly credentialed wrestler in, you know, let's say you're collegiate Division One or Division Two All-American, how many times do you really think most MMA fighters can take you down? It's not a normal place to be in. You're always using it either offensively or just defensively. You're so good you can keep people on the feet. The one thing Tyron really does have going for him in this fight, because let's face it, stylistically, this is a brutal matchup for him, because we've seen what Colby Covington can do is basically what Gilbert Burns did and the same thing Usman did to Woodley. I'm going to hit you as many times as possible. I'm going to make you tired. I'm going to take you down a bunch. And just keep on switching it up. You're a little bit older. You probably can't keep up with me cardio-wise. Colby Covington is much more hittable than those other two fighters. Kamaru Usman's defense is absurd. Now, Masvidal, oddly enough, was able to kind of clip him with a few combinations, but that was more just Masvidal's a really crafty boxer, and he doesn't have the one-hit shot, I wouldn't say, of a Tyron Woodley. Yes, he's a good knockout puncher, don't get me wrong, but with him, it's much more technique-oriented than just, like, brute force. And the other thing, Covington, if he gets you up against the cage and starts landing his combinations, he's open to being hit with counters. Luckily, he has a great chin, and defensively, he's good enough that he can avoid some shots. But if you're a guy like Woodley, who A, puts his back up to the cage anyways, and B, has really good power when his back is up against the cage, like the Darren Till fight. Darren Till, he's got that big, like, and then he goes to land, and then he just walked into a big shot at Tyron Woodley's. And if he lands that same shot on Covington, the issue is, unless he puts him out completely, if he just drops him like he did against Till, he won't be able to dominate him from the top position like he did Till. Because Darren Till's not a bad grappler by any means. He's not a Colby Covington-esque grappler, though. He's not a guy who, if he's on his back, can basically just pop up because there's no wrestling transition he doesn't know. So I don't really know what Tyron Woodley does. I think he has to go to the leg kick like he used a lot in the earlier part of his career. You see those massive tree trunks that he walks around on. He's legged up. And if he throws those calf kicks, he always damages his opponent. It's just a matter of he doesn't ever seem disciplined to really use it past the first 3-4 minutes of a fight.
He's one of the biggest fighters you're going to find at 170 pounds. I mean, it's crazy to think that he stayed at 170 for so long. He's what? He's 5'9", if I'm not mistaken. So he's not tall for the division, but he is big. And you saw it. I mean, when he was a champ and even after that, he had a hard time making weight. You'd see him on the scale looking terrible, worrying, how's he going to perform on fight night? And he did. He always did. But you do have to worry about it. Later stage of his career. Now, is weight cutting an issue for him? No, not whatsoever. I'm actually giving him credit here. You'd see him look bad on the scale. The next night, it's the old Tyron Woodley, and he looks fine. So the weight cut has never been an issue, and I don't expect it to be one here. Colby Covington open as a minus 250 favorite, trending around a minus 350 at this point. Woodley open as a plus 210, now at a plus 270. I get it. It's a tough one. If you look over on Tapology for the votes, out of 851, 82% with Covington, 84% by decision. I picked a fair amount of underdogs on this card. This is probably one of the bigger favorites that I'm going with. But in terms of underdogs, I went with Derek Minner to get the win over TJ Laramie. I went with Sarah Alpar to get the win over Jessica Rose Clark. I also went with
Cowboy Cerrone,
Ryan Spann. So I went with a fair amount of underdogs in this card. We have 14 total fights, and about 60% of the time, you're going to get some underdogs that hit. But I mean, this is one where I can't side with the underdog. It's a shame. Would I like to see Tyron Woodley go out there and get a win and kind of flip the script? I mean, hey, it could happen in the co-main event for Cerrone. If it were to happen for Tyron Woodley, I mean, what a good cap to the end of the night. I just don't see it happening against Colby Covington. It's tough to tell what you're going to get in Covington in this fight. But I could say the same thing about Woodley. I expect him to show up. I expect him to go out there and power punch. I haven't seen it in 2 years, and it's tough for me to go that way.
And that's a really great way to set it up, because Tyron Woodley at his best, can he beat the best Colby Covington? Of course he can. But the best Colby Covington is the one that we've seen as of late, and the best Tyron Woodley, like you had mentioned, he's a few years behind us. The one thing, though, can Woodley knock out Colby Covington? Of course he can. But do I really want to rely on just that Hail Mary shot? And this isn't a championship fight, but this is a championship caliber fight. Like, these guys are both always in the conversation for title discussion. The only thing you said about the co-main event that started to make sparks fly, if Cowboy wins and Woodley loses, that's the fight. I mean, you give Woodley a guy who's not only a wrestler, you can kind of just let him have a striking match for once. It'd be a great fight. It'd be one for the fans. Would have nothing to do with the rankings. Don't even know why I mentioned it, but that'd be pretty dope. But no, Colby Covington, more likely than not, going to outpace, out-wrestle, and just kind of keep that pressure on that we know him for. It's not that Woodley's going to wilt under it like we've seen him in the past. Maybe Woodley is being truthful when he's going to let his hands go. But at this stage in both guys' careers, it's just really hard to pick Tyron Woodley. So you got to go with Covington.
No, Matt, I gave away some of my underdog picks there. You've got some as well. So you're going to want to keep it locked in with Fight Night Picks. Check out the playlist. We've got a great episode coming up of Question Mark Kicks. If any of these fights fall out, you get a chance to look at post-weigh-ins, maybe a little bit more tape study. So be sure to join us an hour before the card on Saturday. Typically, I throw that video out there near the end of the week. You can subscribe. You can click notifications. Get ready for it. I'm really looking forward to this card. All sorts of great fights. I'm going with Covington. You're going to go with Covington. And Matt, wouldn't it be something if Tyron Woodley won that fight? But keep it locked in with Fight Night Picks, Matt. And as we always say, let's get into it.